Now notice what he had to say. And say unto him, take heed and be quiet. Fear not, neither be faint-hearted, for the two tails of these smoking firebrands, for the fierce anger of Rezin with Syria and the son of Remaliah. Verse 5 now, because Syria, Ephraim, and the son of Remaliah have taken evil counsel against thee, saying, let us go up against Judah and vex it. Let us make a breach therein for us, and set a king in the midst of it, even the son of Tabeel. Thus saith the Lord God, it shall not stand, neither shall it come to pass. For the head of Syria is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is Rezin, and within 65 years shall Ephraim be broken, and it be not a people. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria, the head of Samaria is Remaliah's son. If ye will not believe, surely ye shall not be established. Now the tenor of the message here was to let Ahaz know that he need not fear the alliance of his two enemies in the north. God had determined that their venture was a failure. Now, the question is, how will this man, Ahaz, know it? To begin with, he's an unbeliever. He's a skeptic. He's a cynic. And how will he be convinced? Well, may I say this to you today? God has never asked anyone to believe anything that doesn't rest upon a firm foundation. I don't know why people think today that it means to blindly move into some area and say, oh, I'm trusting God. My friend, that's very foolish. God never asked you to do that. You see, even our salvation today, we don't bring a little lamb. We look back in faith to a historical fact, coming into the world of the Son of God. It rests upon his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Those are historical facts. God never asked you to take a leap in the dark. He asked you to believe and trust something that rests upon a firm foundation. And it is a firm foundation. And it's the only foundation. No other foundation can any man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, God is not asking you to build air castles out in space. And this unbeliever here is asked now to get on a foundation. God's not asking him to believe it just because Isaiah said it. And very candidly, if you are an honest person and an unbeliever and you really want to know, God will let you beat your music out. You'll come to a faith if you really mean business. And my experience has been the folk today that are unbelievers that I've dealt with, I had a young fella say to me, he was a hippie up here in San Francisco. Oh, he said, I want to believe. I'm searching for the truth. Was he searching for the truth? Living with a girl in adultery. You know, the problem is that no man's eyes are closed today. There's no veil there except you put it there. And if you really want to know, you give up your sin and you want to turn to Christ, he'll make it real to you. The problem today is a great many really don't mean business with God at all. And this king here, he doesn't mean business. Listen to him. Moreover, the Lord spake again unto Ahaz, saying, now I come to verse 11, ask thee a sign of the Lord thy God. Ask it either in the depth or in the height above. In other words, God says, I'll strengthen your faith. Now, I know you don't have any, but I'll give you faith. And the way I'll give it to you, ask for a sign. I'll give you a sign. Now, this man's a pious fraud, and there are a whole lot of those around today, too. Verse 12, but Ahaz said, listen to this pious pickle here. He says, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. Now, isn't that nice and sweet of him? He sounds so nice, but he is without doubt as big a hypocrite you'll find in the scripture. This is the thing that I think makes God sick. I think it makes him really sick at his tummy today. It's this kind of crowd that in the church, God says he's going to spew out of his mouth someday. And that's exactly what you have here. God says, I'm going to give you a sign. I hope you won't mind me telling this little story about a Sunday school class of little juniors, boys and girls, and the teacher was giving them the parable of the Good Samaritan. And I want to tell you, she was laying it on pretty heavy and thick. She told about that man that fell among thieves. My, he'd been beaten up, lying there in his blood, you know, and it was gushing out everywhere. And she really laid it on, then told about the priest and the Pharisee, and finally the Good Samaritan. Then she wanted to clinch it by making an application. She went around the class, and she said to this little girl, says, oh, now, what would you have done? And this little girl says, oh, I would have done what the Good Samaritan did, and I would have stayed there and nursed him a few days. Well, the next little boy, he didn't want to be outdone. He says, I would have got him a box of candy. And around it went and finally came to a little girl. And I tell you, she had her face all puckered up. And she said to her, says, what would you do? And she says, I think I'd throw up. Well, believe me, the teacher had really painted a picture. And that little girl was honest, by the way. And I thank God to this type of thing. That's what he says to the church in Laodicea. I think I'm going to throw up. He says, I'll spew you out of my mouth. My friend, don't think you're being pious when you say, oh, I won't test God. God says, test me, try me, and see if I'm not good. All these folk today, they make me weary. And I have fatigue when I talk to some pious folk in the way that they say that they're just going to step out on faith. My friend, wait till God puts a rock underneath you. Wait till God gives you pretty definite leading before you make a fool of yourself and bring down upon the cause of Christ criticism today. Now, God says to him, he said, hear ye now, house of David, is it a small thing for you to weary men? But will ye weary my God also? And that's what God says, you make me tired. I don't like that at all. Now, God says, you won't ask for a sign? I'm going to give you a sign, not to you, Ahaz. You are a fraud. You are a pseudo-king to begin with, though you're in the line of David. But there's going to come one later on. Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Who? To the house of David. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, shall call his name Emmanuel. God put a foundation under it. And if you want to know whether the virgin birth is true or not, you can find out if you'll turn and read the four Gospels. God has put a good solid foundation under this great truth today. And you're just being pious when you say, I don't think it's necessary to believe the virgin birth. Now, if when you come to Christ, you may not know enough to know about the virgin birth. All you've done is trusted him as Savior. But no Christian can deny the virgin birth. And if you're willing to look at the record, let God put a foundation under you, you'll believe the virgin birth. That's the meaning, I think, of this entire passage of Scripture. Now, he says, before this child is even weaned, and that both kingdoms will have been gone, and they were. Because at the time the Lord Jesus was born there in Bethlehem, they had already been to captivity, all of them. And the whole 12 tribes, they had all come back. Not all of them, a very small remnant, even of Judah. And there were Levites that came. And of the other tribes, they were there. But it was just a remnant when he came to the earth. This is a remarkable chapter. Next time, we're going to take up chapter 8. Until then, may God richly bless you, my beloved.